Hello and welcome to the opening session of Digital Discourses Journalism in the Digital Age. Herzlich willkommen zur Eröffnungsveranstaltung der digitalen Diskurse, Journalismus im digitalen Zeitalter. This conference has been put together by Goethe-Institut Indonesian, the German Embassy Jakarta, Deutsche Welle, and Project Multatuli. I'm Marissa Anita, your MC for this opening session. Digital Discourses was initiated in 2019 with the aim to stimulate a debate about the impact digital transformation has on individuals, economics, politics, society, and ecology. Now, this year, we will take a look at the future of journalism. In recent years, conventional media across the globe has experienced rapid change. The digital age has transformed the way information is produced as well as consumed. Now, many people use social media as their primary source of news instead of print journalism. Online news articles are gauged by speed and clicks at the expense of in-depth reportage. This has caused a growing concern that digital media is failing to uphold the fundamental values of journalism. What are some other important developments in today's journalism? AI in the newsroom affects journalism practice. Citizen journalism and other forms of grassroots journalism have added fresh approaches to the way news is produced. And all of these developments have contributed to the shift in the way media operate. In Digital Discourses 2021, there will be 6 panel discussions by 24 speakers from 7 countries. And over the next 2 days, we will share, listen, and learn from one another about 6 important topics in digital journalism. They are: is there a place for journalism in social media? The art of investigation, open source intelligence tools for journalists, turning readers into subscribers, citizen journalism, the power of the people, AI in the newsroom, friend or foe, and journalism today and tomorrow. All of these are very important discussions that you wouldn't want to miss over the next 2 days. In this opening session, we will listen to a keynote speech from Dr. Bartosz Wilczek, titled Towards Responsible AI in Local Journalism. But to kickstart this 2-day conference, I would like to invite the Secretary General of Goethe-Institut, Mr. Johannes Ebert, to give his opening remarks. Herr Ebert, the screen is yours.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, dear friends. It is a great pleasure for me to open this virtual conference on the transformation of journalism in the digital age. Almost every aspect of our lives now is touched by the rapid digital transformation. The way we communicate, the way we teach and learn, the way we shop, and the way we work. At the same time, these new technologies and a new economic system that takes shape with this change are posing social, ethical, and political challenges. These challenges need to be explored and negotiated. When the Goethe-Institut initiated the conference series Digital Discourses in 2019, it was initiated within this context of a rapidly increasing digital transformation. The series was initiated to stir a debate about the impact digital transformation has on many aspects of our lives. And this can vary significantly from society to society and from region to region. Which is why, since its beginning, this conference series has promoted and fostered an exchange of viewpoints and of ideas between Southeast Asia and Europe. Past editions of Digital Discourses were zooming in on topics like the thin line between freedom and restriction in the internet, on the question of data privacy and data sovereignty in the age of platforms, and on the state of digital civil society in the Southeast Asia region. The edition of Digital Discourses that we are opening today will take a close look at how the digital transformation impacts the way media operate across the globe. Online news articles are now an important source of information, often much more so than printed news. However, online journalism and online news production in general often are focused on speed and clicks at the expense of in-depth reportage. Under increased pressure to generate revenue from digital publishing, concerns are growing that digital media will increasingly struggle to uphold the fundamental values of journalism and democratic ideals. In addition to this, an avalanche of misinformation and hoax news trigger new and well-known challenges in today's society. The COVID-19 crisis, to name only one example, has illustrated how harmful the repercussion of this can be. However, the same digital transformation has also added fresh and very promising approaches to the way news is produced. As an example, the power of open source intelligence provides journalists with new tools for investigative journalism through analyzing huge data sets that are publicly available. Meanwhile, artificial intelligence opens up new methods in producing news that are yet to be fully explored. The massive presence of social media in our daily lives is a new distribution channel for media to connect to a broader audience and to interact. And it is also becoming a platform for grassroots journalism in which citizens can be the creators and distributors of news that contribute to public debate. Modern societies could not be imagined without the presence of mass media. Free and unbiased media is an important pillar of democracy and of global peaceful coexistence. This conference wishes to start a conversation on whether and how the media can continue to fulfill its role in this disruptive digital era. I'm wishing you, dear speakers and participants, an insightful and stimulating conference. Finally, I would like to express the gratitude that we as Goethe-Institut feel for the very fruitful and engaging collaboration with our organizing partners of this conference, namely to the Indonesian Public Journalism Initiative Project Multatuli, the German international broadcaster Deutsche Welle, the Embassy of the Federal Republic of Germany in Jakarta, and of course to all my colleagues at the Goethe-Institut in Jakarta. Thank you very much for this wonderful collaboration organizing this conference. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Herr Ebert, for your warm welcoming remarks. And next, I would like to invite the Ambassador of the Federal Republic of Germany to Indonesia, ASEAN, and Timor-Leste, Her Excellency Ina Lepel, Botschafterin Lepel. The screen is yours.
Dear partners, participants, and viewers, first of all, thank you to our partners, especially the Goethe-Institut, for making this conference series happen and for giving room to discuss the relevant topic of journalism in a digital age and to reflect upon the impact of digital transformation on us in this regard. The pandemic has certainly even accelerated the digital transformation and is sometimes hard to get up to speed in order to debate in depth all impacts and consequences deriving from it. So this conference series is valuable to find answers to these questions and hopefully also some common ground. I've directly been asked to address one question of this complex, that is, what does the transformation of journalism and news consumption mean for diplomacy? That I will try to briefly touch upon. From my personal experience, having served as press officer at the German Embassy in Bangkok and at Foreign Office headquarters many years ago, I can tell you as a practitioner that the terms of cooperation with media and public outreach within the diplomatic service have changed significantly. The change surely is manifold. Firstly, public diplomacy has become more important than it used to be. One can draw the conclusion that the sinister backroom diplomacy of former times is over to a certain degree, and that diplomatic action and operations enter the limelight and are more open to public scrutiny. That helps if public pressure is useful to reach a certain goal, and media interaction often becomes a significant part of the negotiation strategy. However, in sensitive negotiation contexts, public pressure on the negotiators can be counterproductive. Then parties agree to keep silence, All spokespersons and social media teams resort to very bland sound bites in order to create the space needed for mutual concessions. Diplomats try to use their media outreach to pursue their agenda. However, media, especially quality media, are not willing delivery boys and girls, but they play their own active role, investigating the truth behind smooth statements, informing the public, thus keeping the government accountable to the public. It is always healthy to have critics watching, even if it does not always create a comfortable working environment. This complex interaction has probably always existed, but I think that it has grown in importance and the rhythm has accelerated enormously. Almost everything has to happen in real time. The second finding of change throughout the years is the fact that, as many stakeholders, also diplomatic services and missions have broadened their own channels of direct communication to the public, especially through social media. I leave it to your assessment, especially in panel one, social media and journalism, if that is rather a positive or a negative development. But from my point of view, it is clear that this direct communication by stakeholders themselves cannot and should not substitute quality journalism. By the way, it will be interesting to see the outcome of panel six and the debate on the definition of journalism in a digital age and its possible change of role. Finally, pictures and videos have become part of our toolbox to a much larger extent. It is no longer enough for a diplomat to write good text. He or she also has to have a photographer's eye and a good understanding of the emotional impact a picture can have. All this is, of course, also due to the sea change in news consumption brought on by the internet and social media. To conclude, I am eager to hear all the contributions by you, dear participants, from the whole region with your diverse backgrounds. Thank you for your attention and fruitful debates to all of us.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Lepel, for your welcoming remarks. To give the next opening remarks, I would like to invite the Director General of Deutsche Welle, Mr. Peter Limbourg. Herr Limbourg, the screen is yours.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to welcome you to the conference Digital Discourses, Journalism in the Digital Age. To organize this two-day conference in cooperation with the Goethe-Institut Indonesia, the German Embassy in Jakarta and the journalistic initiative project Multatuli is a great pleasure for us at DW. At the same time, this initiative is also proof of the enormous importance of qualitative journalistic products in times of digitization. Digitization is a megatrend. The job of a journalist has never been a monotonous or a routine task. But today, the demands on journalists are becoming ever higher. Not only do they have to work quickly, precisely and creatively, but they also have to master more and more platforms and, of course, be the first. Always be the first. This reminds me of the times when I returned to the newsroom from shooting with several hours of raw footage on a videotape and had time. I had time to edit the video. In those days, journalists were the gatekeepers and made largely exclusive decisions about which topics entered the public discourse and how, mediated by the press, radio or TV. Back then, social media didn't exist. Back then, viewers could also wait. Today, the world looks very different. Instead of the videotape, there is the smart card. Viewers, readers and listeners were joined by users. And they can't wait. Even more, the users themselves disseminate information. Social media sets the tone and offers users a customized news menu based on algorithms. An alternative information cosmos quickly emerges. Fake news floods the world. Journalism has to rethink, and I know it can. Through new distribution channels, modern formats, on demand, interactive, attractive, and creative. Digitalization is provoking the media world and challenging journalists. And that's a good thing, because challenges are the only way to move forward. I wish you a good start for today and many new ideas.
Thank you very much, Herr Limbourg, for your welcoming remarks as well. Digital transformation has changed media in many different ways. And one of the changes is the way media conduct their business. as advertising revenue declines, vacuumed up by giant search engines and social media platforms, many media organizations have developed new models to support their operations. Well, one example is Project Multatuli, a public service journalism initiative which relies on membership to uphold their work of giving voice to the voiceless. Let's have a look at what Project Multatuli is all about in this next video.
Kita pengen jadi media yang counter oligarki.
Kalau ini jalan, yang covering isu kedua ya, dia akan lebih solid lah perencanaannya. Model kayak ProPublica ketika dia bikin program kolaborasi dengan banyak media lokal di Amerika. Nah, kita juga maunya kayak gitu.
Apa bedanya media independen dan yang tidak independen menurut kamu?
Media independen itu kemewahannya adalah bisa cuma peduli dengan kebenaran. Nggak usah peduli dengan kepentingan pemilik atau kepentingan yang lainnya semacam traffic.
Buat Mbak Evi, apa sih arti jurnalisme independen?
Ketika kita sebagai jurnalis, kita bisa menulis tanpa rasa takut atau bukan menulis karena kita diberi sesuatu seperti sogokan. Journalism without fear or favor.
Sekarang mulai terkumpul, saatnya merampungkan kita mau
bahas
apa.
Oke, aku setuju sama explainer itu.
Pertanyaanmu
adalah
apa arti jurnalisme independen buat lo pribadi?
Bebas. Bisa menjalankan kerja-kerja jurnalistik tanpa sensor dari pemerintah, tanpa sensor dari orang-orang yang berkuasa.
Menurut kalian public trust terhadap jurnalis itu sekarang lagi bagus, jelek, sedengan?
Gimana ya?
Mungkin bergantung kali ya, tapi kalau dari aku sendiri sih ngelihatnya ada ketidakpercayaan publik terhadap jurnalisme atau industri jurnalisme yang ada di Indonesia saat ini, karena memang sifatnya itu dia yang nggak lagi ke public interest, tapi sangat bergantung pada yang tadi itu hal-hal yang viral sama sesuatu yang sifatnya adalah mencari yang ramai buat diliput.
Kalau gitu, apa dong yang perlu dilakukan untuk mengembalikan publikasi itu?
Ya, memang harus dibangun pelan-pelan loyalitas publiknya. Paling gampang kita coba mendengarkan mereka, kita tanya langsung apa sih yang mereka inginkan diangkat oleh media sebenarnya, apa sih isu yang sebenarnya matters buat mereka. Kita dengarkan, kita ajak ngobrol, kita benar-benar bangun engagement dengan mereka jadinya.
Udah pasti kita dapat nggak?
Dapat.
Oh, bismillah.
Nah, menurut kalian, apa sih yang membedakan gerakan jurnalisme PR dengan yang lainnya?
Bagaimana PM melibatkan teman-teman di internet dan di media-media lain juga, itu sesuatu yang unik untuk saat ini ya, gerakan jurnalisme saat ini.
Kalau menurutku yang bikin PM unik adalah karena pertama berita kita Creative Commons gitu, kami berita kita boleh dipublikasi, direpublikasi sama semua orang. Dan kemudian ya semangat kolaborasi itu gitu, bahwa berita nggak boleh di gatekeep gitu lah sih.
Oke, kalau gitu apa dong yang bikin gerakan jurnalisme Project Multatuli beda dengan media lain? Atau sama aja jangan-jangan?
Apa ya? Aku apa ya yang beda ya? Menurutku yang beda, yang menarik, yang ditawarkan PM adalah bagaimana kita mau mendengarkan pembaca ya. Biasanya kan jurnalisme tuh yang kita lihat umumnya gitu kan, ya isu apa yang lagi ramai aja, tapi kita nggak pernah benar-benar mendengarkan apa keresahan publik gitu.
Laporan membership Devina itu kamu ketinggalan, Ad.
Oh, ada berapa?
Kemarin sore 189 orang yang membayar, transaksinya 49 juta, per bulan ini kita dapat 7 juta 700.
Berapa?
7 juta 700 bulan ini. Total 49 juta.
Kok kecil? 7 juta.
Berarti sepenting itu dukungan publik.
Iya.
Kalau tidak ada publik, tidak ada gerakan jurnalisme publik, tidak ada proyek Multatuli.
That was Project Multatuli. And for you who are interested in knowing more about or wanting to get involved in Project Multatuli, you can access the information on projectmultatuli.org. Now, the role of AI in the newsroom is one of the topics that will be discussed in Digital Discourses 2021. And as promised, we will listen to a keynote speech from Dr. Bartosz Wilczek. Dr. Bartosz Wilczek is a postdoctoral research and teaching assistant at the Department of Media and Communications at Ludwig Maximilian Universität München, Germany. His research focuses on innovation management in news organization. And together with researchers at LMU München, University of Leipzig, University of Amsterdam, VU Amsterdam, and University of Stavanger, he is currently investigating drivers and constraints of responsible AI in local journalism. Indeed, AI applications along the news value chain offer opportunities for local media to better cope with economic and societal challenges. But to make sure that this happens properly, the application of AI should be responsible. When news organizations use AI, it is important to ask, how can local media increase economic efficiency while also contributing to the democratic role of media in society by adhering to professional values and ethical standards? In his keynote speech, Dr. Wilczek will give this insights on how to move towards responsible AI in local journalism. And now let's listen to what he has to share. Dr. Wilczek, the screen is yours.
Dear all, hello together. Warm greetings from Munich. My name is Bartosz Wilczek. I'm currently a postdoc at the University of Munich at the Department of Media and Communication, where I'm researching together with an international and interdisciplinary group of scholars responsible AI in local journalism. It's my great honor and pleasure to give this presentation, to give this keynote on the future of local news media, focusing on responsible AI in local journalism. I would like to start the presentation by introducing the project group, then presenting the core challenge of local news media currently, namely the disruption, and present also a possible solution, namely artificial intelligence in particular. Then I will present two studies that we conducted this year on AI in local journalism, and based on those findings, suggest six scenarios regarding organizational and societal conditions that might facilitate responsible AI in local journalism. So we are an international and interdisciplinary group of researchers. Helle Schowak from the University of Stavanger in Norway and myself, we are specialized in media management and economics. Myself, I'm focusing particularly on innovation management in news organizations. Anske Fokkens from the Freie University Amsterdam is specialized in computational linguistics. Natalie Helberger from University of Amsterdam is specialized in AI law and ethics. And Neil Thurman from the University of Munich, Mario Heim from the University of Leipzig, and Wouter van Adveld from the Freie University Amsterdam are specialized in computational communication. But first things first, what is the core challenge of local news media currently? It's the disruption. So local newspaper organizations in particular, and in fact across media markets, have experienced comparatively high degrees of disruption. This means their advertising and audience revenues have been relatively strongly declining. Therefore, a major challenge facing journalism today lies in the collapse of local news provision. This is having serious consequences for local communities and, more broadly, for societies. Now, there are no clear-cut definitions of local journalism. There is, however, an over-agreement in the literature to differentiate local journalism from hyperlocal and national journalism. So hyperlocal journalism is often created by citizen journalists, so not professional journalists, at the level, for instance, of specific areas in cities. National journalism is, of course, created, produced, distributed by national news organizations that also cover international news, national news, and to some degree, regional and local news. However, Möhring and Keltnik from Germany suggest operating this term, local journalism, based on specific criteria, particularly based on specific administrative areas in which news organizations operate. They differ depending on the research design, they differ also depending on a specific country. However, based on Möhring and Keltnik, in Germany we operationalize local journalism on a continuum between local and regional. So we define local journalism as journalism that operates at the level of so-called Landkreise and Regierungsbezirke, which are specific administrative areas in Germany. Now, what is a possible solution for local news media to survive in the digital age? We argue that one solution is technology and artificial intelligence in particular. So AI offers opportunities for local newspaper organizations to better cope with the economic challenges they face. However, the adoption of AI, so the development and implementation of AI in local journalism, raises also concerns. Namely, whether efficiency-driven AI applications will endanger the societal function of local media, so to produce and distribute accurate and relevant local news. Therefore, scholars have increasingly argued that AI applications, also in local journalism, should be responsible. What does this mean? AI applications should be not only efficiency-driven and support local journalism in overcoming its economic challenges, but they should be also ethics-driven and support local journalism in maintaining its function in a society. Now, broadly speaking, AI is defined as a collection of technologies that relate to a computer system's capacity to perform tasks normally requiring human intelligence. AI draws on algorithms that allow to automate specific tasks. So previous research has shown that larger news organizations are increasingly using such AI applications for different stages of the so-called news value chain. So for instance, regarding the input stage, they use AI, for instance, to detect newsworthy issues and to analyze big data. Regarding the throughput stage, they use AI, for instance, to automatically produce and modify content, so text, pictures, videos. And regarding the output stage, they use AI, for instance, to analyze audience engagement and for the personalized distribution of news content. Now, in this context, what does responsible AI mean? For example, if we take a look at the throughput stage, we argued that AI should not only produce more articles in a faster way, but actually contribute to more accuracy of articles. If you take a look at the output stage, we would argue that AI applications should not only distribute news content according to audiences' preferences, but they should also distribute relevant content and thereby secure diversity of news exposure. However, while AI in journalism as well as local journalism are growing fields of research, so far AI in local journalism specifically has attracted very little attention. In fact, the adoption of responsible AI in local journalism specifically and conditions that might facilitate the adoption of such AI have been completely neglected in previous research. And this is particularly surprising because local news media might benefit from such responsible AI in overcoming their economic challenges while being also able to maintain their function in a society. At the same time, however, as you all know, local news media are constrained in adopting technologies, in adopting AI due to their relatively scarce resources and a lack of know-how. Therefore, in this year, we conducted two studies to explore organizational and societal conditions to facilitate the adoption of responsible AI in local journalism. So in study one, we focused on the German media market. And in study two, we took an international perspective. So in the following, I would like to present the core findings of the studies and, based on these findings, suggest future scenarios regarding organizational and societal conditions that might facilitate the adoption of responsible AI in local journalism. But I would like also to shortly present the research designs of the studies to show how we developed those future scenarios. So study one draws on the theory of diffusion of innovations that explains how organizational and societal conditions shape the adoption of innovations by individual or collective actors. And here we, of course, focus on the adoption of AI in local newspaper organizations. And based on the theory, we developed this conceptual framework and corresponding research questions. Now, the first research question is, how do local newspaper organizations in Germany currently use AI for the input, throughput, and output stages of the news value chain? And we also ask, how do local newspaper organizations in Germany perceive the future potential of AI for the input, throughput, and output stages of the news value chain? Now, regarding the input stage, here we focus on the analysis of big data. Regarding the throughput stage, we focus on the automated production of articles. And regarding the output stage, we focus on the personalized distribution of news content. The next question is, what relative advantage of AI for the input, throughput, and output stages of the news value chain in terms of efficiency and quality do local newspaper organizations in Germany perceive? So the relative advantage relates to artificial intelligence compared to human intelligence. And our third research question is, what attitudes do local newspaper organizations in Germany have towards financial and non-financial support for AI adoption by the private and public sectors? So in the case of the private sector, we are particularly interested in support by platforms, so Google and Facebook. And in the case of the public sector, we are interested in support by the state or by public institutions. Now, to investigate our research questions, we conducted in-depth interviews in 14 local newspaper organizations that we sampled based on the German online traffic database. And we interviewed experts from the editorial side, so for instance, editors-in-chief digital, as well as from the technology side, so for instance, heads of product and technology. And the interviews took place this year via Zoom, and we conducted the study in cooperation with the German School of Journalism in Munich. We transcribed the interviews and analyzed them based on cross-case pattern matching to identify specific patterns that point towards specific scenarios. Now, the findings indicate, first of all, that local newspaper organizations are incrementally adopting AI along the news value chain. In fact, the findings suggest a two-level adoption pattern. First, they are increasingly adopting AI for the throughput stage, so for the automated production of articles, even more so for the input stage, analysis of big data, and in particular for the output stage, so personalized distribution of news content. And this output stage, so the personalized distribution of news content, is currently the core growth area of AI adoption in local newspaper organizations, as expressed by our experts. Second, in the case of the automated production articles, and even more so in the case of the analysis of big data, they are increasingly shifting the efforts from service to hard news. So, for instance, from weather and traffic news towards news regarding COVID-19 and elections. Moreover, in the case of the personalized distribution of news content in turn, they are increasingly moving towards more so-called accuracy. This means they aim to more precisely distribute news content according to their audience's preferences. In fact, throughout all stages of the news value chain, AI adoption is particularly driven by local newspaper organizations' efficiency perceptions. Quality perceptions, on the other hand, play so far a minor role as drivers. So, at the moment, local newspaper organizations are particularly interested to use AI, for instance, to produce more articles in a faster time, or to distribute the news content more precisely according to the audience's preferences. And this has, of course, specific implications. So, for instance, local newspaper organizations move toward more hard news in the case of the automated production of articles, and in the case of the analysis of big data, makes this efficiency orientation even more problematic, as hard news are particularly important for the functioning of a society. Local newspaper organizations aim to more precisely distribute news content according to their audience's preferences, in turn, might constrain that audiences will be actually exposed to such hard news. Moreover, a broad share of the investigated local newspaper organizations has rather negative or mixed attitudes towards financial and non-financial support by the private sector. So platforms such as Google and Facebook, as well as towards financial support by the public sector, so state funding. An argument that was repeatedly expressed is basically the risk of constraining journalistic autonomy. However, the majority of the investigated local newspaper organizations have rather positive attitudes towards non-financial support by the public sector. In fact, they are particularly interested in collaborations with public broadcasters, with media labs, and especially with research institutions to facilitate the adoption of AI. They are also interested in more education and training programs, for instance, offered by journalism schools to facilitate the development and implementation of AI. Okay, so let's move now to study two, which draws on organizational ambidexterity theory. And this theory basically explains how organizational and societal conditions facilitate so-called ambidextrous organizations. So organizations that are able to balance exploitation and exploration. Exploitation means maintaining established strategies, while exploration means innovating new strategies. And in this study, exploitation refers to human decision-making, while exploration refers to AI decision-making. Accordingly, we define ambidextrous local newspaper organizations as news organizations that are able to balance human and AI decision-making along the news value chain. Again, based on this theory, we first developed this conceptual framework and corresponding research questions. So the first research question is, what are the most relevant AI applications for local newspaper organizations? The second research question is, what are the most relevant efficiency and ethics principles for these AI applications? And we also aimed to investigate the most relevant approaches to implement this efficiency and ethics principles for this AI application. So drawing on ambidexterity theory and previous research regarding AI in journalism, We identified four possible approaches. So contextual AI means that AI would be able to simultaneously perform efficiency and ethics. Sequential AI means that the AI is able to first, for instance, focus on efficiency and then on ethics. Structural approach means, first of all, hybrid collaboration between several AI applications. So one focuses on efficiency, the other on ethics. And we also have, of course, a further structural approach, namely hybrid collaboration between AI and humans. So for instance, AI would focus on efficiency while humans would focus on ethics. And our fourth research question is, what are the most relevant organizational and societal conditions to facilitate the implementation of efficient and ethical AI applications? Now, in terms of organizational conditions, we focus on conditions within organizations, but we also considered conditions between organizations or collaborations. And in terms of societal conditions, we have focused on funding, so financial support, but also on policy, meaning, regulation. Now, to investigate these research questions, we conducted in-depth interviews with 22 international and interdisciplinary experts in two waves. In the first wave, we interviewed academics specialized in AI journalism or local journalism. We sampled this type of experts because it's a new field of research and a very emerging area of AI development in the new sector. Now, the findings regarding research question one showed that the personalized distribution of news content is currently a particularly relevant area of AI adoption in local newspaper organizations. Therefore, in the second wave, we interviewed experts specialized in this AI application to investigate research question two and four in more detail. So we interviewed experts in local and national newspaper organizations, as well as experts in AI think tanks. And the interviews took place also early 2021 this year via Zoom. Again, we transcribed those interviews and analyzed the data based on cross-case pattern matching to identify patterns that again will point towards specific future scenarios. Now, the findings show, first of all, that our interviewed experts perceive that the personalized distribution of news content is a particularly relevant AI application along the news value chain for local newspaper organizations currently. After all, this AI application contributes to solving local newspaper organizations' core challenge, namely to increase audience engagement and audience revenues. Thereby, the findings mirror results from study one, which have shown that local newspaper organizations in Germany see the biggest future potential of AI in the personalized distribution of news content. However, the findings indicate also that the development of efficiency and ethics principles for AI-driven personalized distribution of news content in particular is very much at an early stage. Experts addressed a wide range of possible efficiency and ethics principles, respectively goals. However, in terms of efficiency principles, they argued that with the introduction of ethics, efficiency or efficiency goals will need to be adjusted. For instance, by moving from short-term towards long-term audience metrics. So personalized distribution of news content, which is responsible, might in the future less aim to increase, for instance, page impressions, but rather focus, for instance, on visits or audiences' time spent on the news website. Second, in terms of ethics principles, they addressed constructs such as diversity, non-bias, and relevance. However, most often they mentioned or addressed news exposure diversity, which seems to emerge as a core ethics principles regarding personalized distribution of news content. Moreover, most experts argued for a structural approach to balancing efficiency and ethics principles regarding AI-driven personalized distribution of news content. This means a hybrid approach between AI and journalists. However, several experts also argued that AI should be able to balance efficiency and ethics principles by design. More specifically, they argued for a sequential approach, where AI can be scaled on a continuum between more efficiency orientation and more ethics orientation. However, at the same time, in general, experts were rather uncertain how such structural and sequential approaches should be implemented, which means that this is also a strongly emerging area with trial and error, which we also saw in the investigated news organizations. Now, what are possible intra-organizational facilitators of responsible AI in local journalism? Most experts argued for internal and external co-creation. This means for the development of AI applications together with journalists and audiences in order to consider the needs. So such AI applications should in the future be not only developed by specific technology divisions, but also in close collaboration with journalists, and they should be also tested with audiences. Now, in terms of inter-organizational facilitators, most experts argued that as AI is a relatively resource-intensive technology, local newspaper organizations will in the future more closely work together in the case of development and implementation of AI applications. This means co-opetition. They will collaborate in one area, development of technology, but they will still compete in another area, namely regarding news coverage. Finally, most experts were more in favor of public support for AI adoption than for private support. In particular, they argued for more collaborations, for instance, between research institutions and local news organizations in the development of AI applications, and of course, in particular, in the development of responsible AI applications. Thereby, the findings mirror once more results from study one. Moreover, experts acknowledge the need for regulation to facilitate responsible AI. However, they were uncertain what should be regulated, meaning which applications along the news value chain, in terms of what ethics principles, but also how such regulation should be implemented. For instance, through self-regulation or regulation. Self-regulation, for instance, would mean that, depending on the media system, press councils will play an important role in the future. Now, based on the findings of studies 1 and 2, we would like to suggest 6 scenarios regarding responsible AI in local journalism. First, the personalized distribution of news content will become a particularly relevant AI application in local newspaper organizations. Moreover, local newspaper organizations will increasingly move towards more so-called accuracy. This means they will more precisely distribute news content according to their audience's preferences. Second, regarding the personalized distribution of news content specifically, local newspaper organizations will increasingly develop efficiency and ethics principles, as well as approaches to balance these principles, with the goal to stimulate more diverse exposure to information and to break potential filter bubbles rather than create them. And with the introduction of ethics principles, efficiency principles will be adapted, meaning from shorter term to longer term audience metrics. Third, internal and external co-creation, so the development of AI applications together with journalists and audience members, will become increasingly relevant intra-organizational conditions to facilitate responsible AI applications in local newspaper organizations. Fourth, co-opetition will become an increasingly relevant intra-organizational condition to facilitate responsible AI applications in local newspaper organizations. This means local newspaper organizations which have scarce resources will collaborate in the future more closely together in the development of such technology to create synergies, for instance, but they will remain competitors in the case of news coverage. Fifth, public non-financial support will become an increasingly relevant societal condition to facilitate responsible AI applications in local newspaper organizations. Here we see particularly the chance of research institutions to collaborate with local newspaper organizations to support them in the development of AI. At the same time, we argue that research institutions will also have a responsibility to support local newspaper organizations in the development and implementation of responsible AI. That is not only efficiency, but also ethics driven. And sixth, finally, regulation will also become an increasingly relevant societal condition to facilitate responsible AI applications in local newspaper organizations. Whether and to what degree AI in journalism will be regulated or self-regulated, this will of course also depend on the media system in which local news media operate. However, in Europe, we see, of course, already developments towards the regulation of AI, for instance, by the European Commission, and that will, as we argue, also shape AI in local journalism. Now, the findings of Study 1 and Study 2 reveal relatively strong patterns that point towards future scenarios regarding the adoption of responsible AI in local journalism. However, both studies draw on explorative methods, therefore the findings are of course not representative. Also not regarding the German media market, for instance. Accordingly, a promising path for future research would be to conduct representative online surveys. In fact, a further promising path for future research would be to conduct comparative studies to more systematically investigate differences between media systems around the world, a step we are currently preparing. And with that, I would like to thank you very much for your attention on behalf of the whole research group. I am looking very much forward to discussing our scenarios with you, and to also learn from your international perspective on the future of local news media. Thank you very much and goodbye.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bartosz Wilczek, for sharing your knowledge and findings in your insightful keynote speech. Well, that wraps the opening session of Digital Discourses 2021. Coming up are six panel discussions by 24 speakers from Southeast Asia and Europe, all up for sharing their experience and exchanging knowledge with one another around the transformation of journalism and news consumption in the digital age. Thank you so much for your kind attention and participation in the opening session of Digital Discourses 2021. Vielen Dank für Ihr Interesse und Ihr Teilnahme an der Eröffnungsveranstaltung der digitalen Diskurse 2021. It's been a great pleasure to host the opening session and share this moment with you. I'm Marissa Anita signing off. I wish you a rich sharing and learning experience over the next 2 days in Digital Discourses 2021. Danke und bis zum nächsten Mal. Thank you and see you next time.